3 months in the Southern States, April to June, 1863, by Arthur James Lyon Fremantle. Narrated by Michael Page. This unabridged audiobook was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction: An Englishman at Gettysburg, by Ian Cameron Martin. Arthur James Lyon Fremantle was a professional British Army officer born in 1835 into a distinguished military family. Within a year of graduating from Sandhurst in 1852, he was assigned as an ensign to Her Majesty's Coldstream Guards, an elite regiment of the Guards Division in which his father, Major General John Fremantle, had commanded a battalion. In 1860, he was promoted to Lieutenant Colonel and appointed Assistant Military Secretary at Gibraltar. When war broke out in America between the states in 1861, Fremantle and other British officers showed a keen professional interest in the events. Fremantle's curiosity about the Southern cause was piqued by a chance encounter in January 1862, when the Confederate raider CSS Sumter, under Captain Raphael Semmes, arrived in Gibraltar seeking repairs. Regaled by tales of blockade running and the plight of the Confederacy, Fremantle decided to take a leave of absence from his duties and travel to the Southern states as a neutral observer. On 2 March 1863, Fremantle left England on board the mail steamer Atrato and headed to Havana, planning to enter Texas through Mexico. Thus began a remarkable trek that would lead him through the Confederacy during the critical months of May and June. As he moved northwards, he kept a journal of his exploits and detailed notes on each encounter with Confederate leaders. On June 27, armed with a letter of introduction from Secretary of War James A. Seddon, Fremantle attached himself to the headquarters of Lieutenant General James Longstreet as Lee's army marched towards Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Over the next 6 days, Fremantle would record the greatest battle ever fought on American soil from the viewpoint of the Southern High Command, a candid account of events and people priceless for later historians. On the afternoon of July 3, as he watched the shattered survivors of Pickett's charge make their way back to Confederate lines, he accompanied General Lee, who was engaged in rallying and encouraging the broken troops and was riding about a little in front of the wood. His face, which is always placid and cheerful, did not show signs of the slightest disappointment, care, or annoyance. And he was addressing to every soldier he met a few words of encouragement, such as, "All this will come right in the end. We'll talk it over afterwards. But in the meantime, all good men must rally." Very few failed to answer his appeal, and I saw many badly wounded men take off their hats and cheer him. Thus, by fortune and chance, Fremantle bore witness to the Confederacy's greatest and most tragic day. Fremantle left New York for England on July 15, amidst the violence of the anti-draft riots that terrorized the city. Encouraged by friends to publish a record of his travels, he turned to his diary of notes and completed 3 months in the Southern states in 1864. Well received in England, it was also printed and widely read in both the Union and the Confederacy. Although Fremantle was not uncritical in his observations of Southern arrogance and poorly equipped soldiers, he was deeply moved by what he saw as the devotion of the whole population of the Southern states to their cause of independence in a war of Northern aggression and conquest. In the end, he predicted a Southern victory. "I never can believe that in the 19th century the civilized world will be condemned to witness the destruction of such a gallant race." By the time of the book's printing, as the tide of war turned against the Confederacy, it was surely viewed as a ray of hope by Southern readers as the stars of their rebel flag dimmed. Fremantle went on with his distinguished career, promoted to Major General in 1881 and serving in the Sudan against the Mahdist uprising, where he saw action at the Battle of Tamai in 1884. He would end his career as Governor General of Malta from 1894 to 1899. 3 months in the Southern states fell into obscurity after the Civil War until 1952, when it was republished by Walter Lord as the Fremantle Diary. The now famous Englishman was portrayed twice more in the following years, As a key protagonist of Michael Shara's Pulitzer Prize-winning novel The Killer Angels in 1974, and in the book's 1993 film adaptation in Gettysburg, with Fremantle's role superbly acted by James Lancaster. Thus, over time, the book has taken its rightful place among Civil War literature as a record of the most important observer to visit the Confederacy. Perhaps the greatest praise of Fremantle and his remarkable account comes from the eminent Southern historian Douglas Southall Freeman, who noted, "A more dignified picture of the Confederate cause could not have been presented." Preface. At the outbreak of the American War, in common with many of my countrymen, I felt very indifferent as to which side might win. But if I had any bias, my sympathies were rather in favor of the North, on account of the dislike which an Englishman naturally feels at the idea of slavery. But soon a sentiment of great admiration for the gallantry and determination of the Southerners, together with the unhappy contrast afforded by the foolish bullying conduct of the Northerners, caused a complete revulsion in my feelings, and I was unable to repress a strong wish to go to America and see something of this wonderful struggle. Having successfully accomplished my design, I returned to England and found amongst all my friends an extreme desire to know the truth of what was going on in the South, for, in consequence of the blockade, the truth can with difficulty be arrived at, as intelligence coming mainly through northern sources is not believed, and, in fact, nowhere is the ignorance of what is passing in the South more profound than it is in the northern states. In consequence of a desire often expressed, I now publish the diary which I endeavored, as well as I could, to keep up day by day during my travels throughout the Confederate States. The latter portion of the diary, which has reference to the Battle of Gettysburg, has already appeared in Blackwood's magazine, and the interest with which it was received has encouraged me to publish the remainder. I have not attempted to conceal any of the peculiarities or defects of the Southern people. Many persons will doubtless highly disapprove of some of their customs and habits in the wilder portion of the country. But I think no generous man, whatever may be his political opinions, can do otherwise than admire the courage, energy, and patriotism of the whole population, and the skill of its leaders in this struggle against great odds. And I am also of the opinion that many will agree with me in thinking that a people in which all ranks and both sexes display a unanimity and a heroism which can never have been surpassed in the history of the world is destined, sooner or later, to become a great and independent nation. 3 months in the Southern States, April, May, June, 1863. 2nd March, 1863. I left England in the Royal Mail steamer Atrato and arrived at St. Thomas on the 17th. 22nd March, anchored at Havana at 6:15 a.m., where I fell in with my old friend HM's frigate Immortality. Captain Hancock not only volunteered to take me as his guest to Matamoros, but also to take a Texan merchant whose acquaintance I had made in the Atrato. This gentleman's name is McCarthy. He is of Irish birth, an excellent fellow and a good companion, and when he understood my wish to see the South, he had most good-naturedly volunteered to pilot me over part of the Texan deserts. I owe much to Captain Hancock's kindness. 23rd March. Left Havana in HMS Immortality at 11 a.m. Knocked off steam when outside the harbor. 1st April. Anchored at 8:30 p.m., 3 miles from the mouth of the Rio Grande, or Rio Bravo del Norte, which is, I believe, its more correct name, in the midst of about 70 merchant vessels. 2nd April. The Texan and I left the Immortalité in her cutter at 10 a.m. and crossed the bar in fine style. The cutter was steered by Mr. Johnston, the master, and having a fair wind, we passed in like a flash of lightning and landed at the miserable village of Baghdad on the Mexican bank of the Rio Grande. The bar was luckily in capital order, 3.5 feet of water and smooth. It is often impassable for 10 or 12 days together, the depth of water varying from 2 to 5 feet. It is very dangerous from the heavy surf and undercurrent. Sharks also abound. Boats are frequently capsized in crossing it, and the Orlando lost a man on it about a month ago. 70 vessels are constantly at anchor outside the bar, their cotton cargoes being brought to them with very great delays by 2 small steamers from Baghdad. These steamers draw only 3 feet of water and realize an enormous profit. Baghdad consists of a few miserable wooden shanties which have sprung into existence since the war began. For an immense distance, endless bales of cotton are to be seen. Immediately we landed, McCarthy was greeted by his brother merchants. He introduced me to Mr. Ituria, a Mexican, who promised to take me in his buggy to Brownsville, on the Texan bank of the river opposite Matamoros. McCarthy was to follow in the evening to Matamoros. The Rio Grande is very tortuous and shallow. The distance by river to Matamoros is 65 miles, and it is navigated by steamers, which sometimes perform the trip in 12 hours, but more often take 24, so constantly do they get aground. The distance from Baghdad to Matamoros by land is 35 miles, on the Texan side to Brownsville, 26 miles. I crossed the river from Baghdad with Mr. Ituria at 11 o'clock, and, as I had no pass, I was taken before 6 Confederate officers who were seated round a fire contemplating a tin of potatoes. These officers belonged to Duff's cavalry, Duff being my Texan's partner. Their dress consisted simply of flannel shirts, very ancient trousers, jack boots with enormous spurs, and black felt hats ornamented with the Lone Star of Texas. They looked rough and dirty, but were extremely civil to me. The captain was rather a boaster, and kept on remarking, "We've given 'em hell on the Mississippi, hell on the Sabine, and hell in various other places." He explained to me that he couldn't cross the river to see McCarthy, as he with some of his men had made a raid over there 3 weeks ago and carried away some renegados, one of whom, named Montgomery, they had left on the road to Brownsville. By the smiles of the other officers, I could easily guess that something very disagreeable must have happened to Montgomery. He introduced me to a skipper who had just run his schooner, laden with cotton, from Galveston, and who was much elated in consequence. The cotton had cost 6 cents a pound in Galveston, and is worth 36 here. Mr. Ituria and I left for Brownsville at noon. A buggy is a light gig on 4 high wheels. The road is a natural one, the country quite flat and much covered with mesquite trees, very like pepper trees. Every person we met carried a 6-shooter, although it is very seldom necessary to use them. After we had proceeded about 9 miles, we met General B., who commands the troops at Brownsville. He was traveling to Boca del Rio in an ambulance with his Quartermaster General, Major Russell. I gave him my letter of introduction to General Magruder and told him who I was. Author's note: an ambulance is a light wagon and generally has 2 springs behind and 1 transverse in front. The seats can be so arranged that 2 or even 3 persons may lie at full length. He thereupon descended from his ambulance and regaled me with beef and beer in the open. He is brother to the General B. who was killed at Manassas. We talked politics and fraternized very amicably for more than an hour. He said the Montgomery affair was against his sanction, and he was sorry for it. He said that Davis, another renegado, would also have been put to death had it not been for the intercession of his wife. General B. had restored Davis to the Mexicans. 30 minutes after parting company with General B., we came to the spot where Montgomery had been left, and sure enough, about 200 yards to the left of the road, we found him. He had been slightly buried, but his head and arms were above the ground, his arms tied together, the rope still round his neck, but part of it still dangling from quite a small mesquite tree. Dogs or wolves had probably scraped the earth from the body, and there was no flesh on the bones. I obtained this, my first experience of lynch law, within 3 hours of landing in America. I understand that this Montgomery was a man of very bad character, and that, confiding in the neutrality of the Mexican soil, he was in the habit of calling the Confederates all sorts of insulting epithets from the Baghdad bank of the river, and a party of his renegados had also crossed over and killed some unarmed cotton teamsters, which had roused the fury of the Confederates. About 3 miles beyond this, we came to Colonel Duff's encampment. He is a fine-looking, handsome Scotchman, and received me with much hospitality. His regiment consisted of newly raised volunteers, a very fine body of young men who were drilling in squads. They were dressed in every variety of costume, many of them without coats, but all wore the high black felt hat. Notwithstanding the peculiarity of their attire, there was nothing ridiculous or contemptible in the appearance of these men, who all looked thoroughly like business. Colonel Duff told me that many of the privates owned vast tracts of country, with above 100 slaves, and were extremely well off. They were all most civil to me. Their horses were rather raw-boned animals, but hardy and fast. The saddles they used were nearly like the Mexican. Colonel Duff confessed that the Montgomery affair was wrong, but he added that his boys meant well. We reached Brownsville at 5:30 p.m., and Mr. Ituria kindly insisted on my sleeping at his house instead of going to the crowded hotel. 3rd April, Good Friday. At 8 a.m. I got a military pass to cross the Rio Grande into Mexico, which I presented to the sentry, who then allowed me to cross in the ferryboat. Carriages are not permitted to run on Good Friday in Mexico, so I had a hot, dusty walk of more than a mile into Matamoros. Mr. Zorn, the acting British consul, and Mr. Benson, his partner, invited me to live at the consulate during my stay at Matamoros, and I accepted their offer with much gratitude. I was introduced to Mr. Colville, a Manchester man, to Mr. Maloney, one of the principal merchants, to Mr. Bennett, an Englishman, one of the owners of the Peterhof, who seemed rather elated than otherwise when he heard of the capture of his vessel, as he said the case was such a gross one that our government would be obliged to take it up. I was also presented to the gobernador, rather a rough. After dining with Mr. Zorn, I walked back to the Rio Grande, which I was allowed to cross on presenting Mr. Colville's pass to the Mexican soldiers, and I slept at Mr. Ituria's again. Brownsville is a straggling town of about 3,000 inhabitants. Most of its houses are wooden ones, and its streets are long, broad, and straight. There are about 4,000 troops under General B in its immediate vicinity. Its prosperity was much injured when Matamoros was declared a free port. After crossing the Rio Grande, a wide, dusty road about a mile in length leads to Matamoros, which is a Mexican city of about 9,000 inhabitants. Its houses are not much better than those at Brownsville, and they bear many marks of the numerous revolutions which are continually taking place there. Even the British consulate is riddled with the bullets fired in 1861-2. The Mexicans look very much like their Indian forefathers, their faces being extremely dark, and their hair black and straight. They wear hats with the most enormous brims, and delight in covering their jackets and leather breeches with embroidery. Some of the women are rather good-looking, but they plaster their heads with grease and paint their faces too much. Their dress is rather like the Andalusian. When I went to the cathedral, I found it crammed with kneeling women. An effigy of Our Saviour was being taken down from the cross and put into a golden coffin, the priest haranguing all the time about his sufferings, and all the women howling most dismally as if they were being beaten. Matamoros is now infested with numbers of Jews, whose industry spoils the trade of the established merchants to the great rage of the latter. It suffers much from drought, and there had been no rain to speak of for 11 months. I am told that it is a common thing in Mexico for the diligence to arrive at its destination with the blinds down. This is a sure sign that the travelers, both male and female, have been stripped by robbers nearly to the skin. A certain quantity of clothing is then, as a matter of course, thrown in at the window to enable them to descend. Mr. Benson and Mr. Maloney told me they had seen this happen several times, and Mr. Oetling declared that he himself, with three ladies, arrived at the city of Mexico in this predicament. 4th April, Saturday. I crossed the river at 9 a.m. and got a carriage at the Mexican side to take my baggage and myself to the consulate at Matamoros. The driver ill-treated his half-starved animals most cruelly. The Mexicans are even worse than the Spaniards in this respect. I called on Mr. Oetling, the Prussian consul, who is one of the richest and most prosperous merchants in Matamoros, and a very nice fellow. After dinner, we went to a fandango, or open-air fete. About 1,500 people were gambling and dancing bad imitations of European dances. 5th April, Sunday. Mr. Zorn, or Don Pablo as he is called here, Her Majesty's acting vice-consul, is a quaint and most good-natured little man, a Prussian by birth. He is overwhelmed by the sudden importance he has acquired from his office, and by the amount of work, for which he gets no pay, entailed by it, the office of British consul having been a comparative sinecure before the war. Mr. Bainson is head of the firm. The principal place of business is at San Luis Potosi, a considerable city in the interior of Mexico. All these foreign merchants complain bitterly of the persecutions and extortion they have to endure from the government, which are, doubtless, most annoying, but nevertheless they appear to fatten on the Mexican soil. I crossed to Brownsville to see General B., but he had not returned from Boca del Rio. I dined with Mr. Oertling. We were about 14 at dinner, principally Germans, a very merry party. Mr. Oertling is supposed to have made $1 million for his firm by bold cotton speculations since the war. We all went to the theatre afterwards. The piece was an attack upon the French and upon southern institutions. 6th April, Monday. Mr. Benson and Mr. Colville left for Baghdad this morning in a very swell ambulance drawn by 4 gay mules. At noon I crossed to Brownsville and visited Captain Lynch, a quartermaster, who broke open a great box and presented me with a Confederate felt hat to travel in. He then took me to the garrison and introduced me to Colonel Bouchel of the 3rd Texas Regiment, who is by birth a German but had served in the French army, and he prepared cocktails in the most scientific manner. I returned to Matamoros at 2:30 p.m. Captain Hancock and Mr. Anderson, the paymaster, arrived from Baghdad in a most miserable vehicle at 4 p.m. They were a mass of dust and had been 7 hours on the road after having been very nearly capsized on the bar. There was a great firing of guns and squibs in the afternoon, in consequence of the news of a total defeat of the French at Puebla, with a loss of 8,000 prisoners and 70 pieces of cannon. Don Pablo, who had innocently hoisted his British flag in honor of Captain Hancock, was accused by his brother merchants of making a demonstration against the French. After dinner, we called on Mr. Maloney, whose house is gorgeously furnished and who has a pretty wife. 7th April, Tuesday. Mr. Maloney sent us his carriage to conduct Captain Hancock, Mr. Anderson, and myself to Brownsville. We first called on Colonels Luckett and Bouchel. The former is a handsome man, a doctor by profession, well-informed and agreeable, but most bitter against the Yankees. We sat for an hour and a half talking with these officers and drinking endless cocktails, which were rather good, and required 5 or 6 different liquids to make them. We then adjourned to General B's, with whom we had another long talk, and with whom we discussed more cocktails. At the General's, we were introduced to a well-dressed, good-looking Englishman who, however, announced to us that he had abjured his nationality until Great Britain rendered justice to the South. Author's note. It seems he has been dreadfully riled by the late Peterhoff affair. 2 years since, this individual had his house burnt down, and a few days ago, happening to hear that one of the incendiaries was on the Mexican bank of the river, boasting of the exploit, he rowed himself across, shot his man, and then rowed back. I was told afterwards that notwithstanding the sentiments he had given out before us, he is a staunch Britisher, always ready to produce his 6-shooter at a moment's notice, at any insult to the Queen or to England. We were afterwards presented to a rather sinister-looking party, with long yellow hair down to his shoulders. This is the man who is supposed to have hanged Montgomery. We were treated by all the officers with the greatest consideration and conducted to the place of embarkation with much ceremony. Colonel Luckett declared I should not leave Brownsville until General Magruder arrives. He is expected every day. Mr. Maloney afterwards told us that these officers, having given up everything for their country, were many of them in great poverty. He doubted whether the man with long yellow hair had a second pair of boots in the world. But he added that, to do honour to the British officers, they would scour Brownsville for the materials for cocktails. At 3 p.m. we dined with Mr. Maloney, who is one of the principal and most enterprising British merchants at Matamoros, and enjoyed his hospitality till 9:30. His wine was good, and he made us drink a good deal of it. Mr. Ertling was there, and his stories of highway robberies and of his journeys en chemise were most amusing. At 10 p.m. Mr. Ertling conducted us to the grand fandango given in honor of the reported victory over the French. A Mexican fandango resembles a French ducasse, with the additional excitement of gambling. It commences at 9:30 and continues till daylight. The scene is lit up by numerous paper lanterns of various colors. A number of benches are placed so as to form a large square, in the center of which the dancing goes on, the men and women gravely smoking all the time. Outside the benches is the promenade bounded by the gambling tables and drinking booths. On this occasion, there must have been 30 or 40 gambling tables, some of the smaller ones presided over by old women and others by small boys. Monte is the favorite game, and the smallest silver coin can be staked, or a handful of doubloons. Most of these tables were patronized by crowds of all classes intent on gambling, with grave, serious faces under their enormous hats. They never moved a muscle, whether they won or lost. Although the number of people at these fandangos is very great, yet the whole affair is conducted with an order and regularity not to be equaled in an assembly of a much higher class in Europe. If there ever is a row, it is invariably caused by Texans from Brownsville. These turbulent spirits are at once seized and cooled in the calaboose. 8th April, Wednesday. Poor Don Pablo was taken ill at breakfast and was obliged to go to bed. We were all much distressed at his illness, which was brought on by over-anxiety connected with his official duties, and the way he is bothered by English and blue-nose Nova Scotian skippers is enough to try anyone. Mr. Bainson and Mr. Colville returned from Baghdad this afternoon, much disgusted with the attractions of that city. General B's orderly was assaulted in Matamoros yesterday by a renegado with a six-shooter. This circumstance prevented the general from coming to Matamoros as he had intended. At 5 p.m., Captain Hancock and I crossed over to Brownsville and were conducted in a very smart ambulance to General B's quarters, and afterwards to see a dress parade of the 3rd Texas Infantry. Lieutenant Colonel Bouchel is the working man of the corps, as he is a professional soldier. The men were well clothed, though great variety existed in their uniforms. Some companies wore blue, some gray, some had French kepi, others wideawakes and Mexican hats. They were a fine body of men and really drilled uncommonly well. They went through a sort of guard mounting parade in a most creditable manner. About 100 out of 1,000 were conscripts. Author's note. During all my travels in the South, I never saw a regiment so well clothed or so well drilled as this one, which has never been in action or been exposed to much hardship. After the parade, we adjourned to Colonel Luckett's to drink prosperity to the 3rd Regiment. We afterwards had a very agreeable dinner with General B. Colonels Luckett and Bouchel dined also. The latter is a regular soldier of fortune. He served in the French and Turkish armies, as also in the Carlist and the Mexican wars, and I was told he had been a principal in many affairs of honor. But he is a quiet and unassuming little man, and although a sincere southerner, is not nearly so violent against the Yankees as Luckett. At 10 p.m., Captain Hancock and myself went to a ball given by the authorities of the Heroica y Invicta Ciudad de Matamoros, as they chose to call it, in honor of the French defeat. General B. and Colonel Luckett also went to this fete, the invitation being the first civility they had received since the violation of the Mexican soil and the Davis-Montgomery affair. They were dressed in plain clothes and carried pistols concealed in case of accidents. We all drove together from Brownsville to the consulate and entered the ballroom en masse. The outside of the municipal hall was lit up with some splendor, and it was graced by a big placard, on which was written the amiable sentiment, Muera Napoleon, Viva Mexico. Semi-successful squibs and crackers were let off at intervals. In the square also was a triumphal arch, with an inscription to the effect that the effete nations of Europe might tremble. I made great friends with the gobernador and administrador, who endeavored to entice me into dancing, but I excused myself by saying that Europeans were unable to dance in the graceful Mexican fashion. Captain Hancock was much horrified when this greasy-faced gobernador, who keeps a small shop, stated his intention of visiting the Immortalité with six of his friends and sleeping on board for a night or two. The dances were a sort of slow valse, and between the dances the girls were planted up against the wall and not allowed to be spoken to by anyone. They were mostly a plain-headed, badly painted lot and ridiculously dressed. 9th April, Thursday. Captain Hancock and Mr. Anderson left for Baghdad in Mr. Bainson's carriage at noon. I crossed over to Brownsville at 11:30 and dined with Colonels Luckett, Bushell, and Duff at about 1 o'clock. As we were all colonels, and as everyone called the other Colonel tout court, it was difficult to make out which was meant. They were obliged to confess that Brownsville was about the rowdiest town of Texas, which was the most lawless state in the Confederacy. But they declared they had never seen an inoffensive man subject to insult or annoyance, although the shooting down and stringing up systems are much in vogue, being almost a necessity in a thinly populated state, much frequented by desperados driven away from more civilized countries. Colonel Luckett gave me a letter to General Van Dorn, whom they consider the beau ideal of a cavalry soldier. They said from time immemorial the Yankees had been despised by the Southerners as a race inferior to themselves in courage and in honorable sentiments. At 3 p.m. Colonel Bushell and I rode to Colonel Duff's camp, distant about 13 miles. I was given a Mexican saddle, in which one is forced to sit almost in a standing position. The stirrups are very long and right underneath you, which throws back the feet. Duff's regiment is called the Partisan Rangers. Although a fine lot of men, they don't look well at a foot parade on account of the small amount of drill they have undergone and the extreme disorder of their clothing. They are armed with carbines and six shooters. I saw some men come in from a scouting expedition against the Indians 300 miles off. They told me they were usually in the habit of scalping an Indian when they caught him, and that they never spared one, as they were such an untamable and ferocious race. Another habit which they have learned from the Indians is to squat on their heels in a most peculiar manner. It has an absurd and extraordinary effect to see a quantity of them so squatting in a row or in a circle. The regiment had been employed in quelling a counter-revolution of Unionists in Texas. Nothing could exceed the rancor with which they spoke of these renegados, as they called them, who were principally Germans. When I suggested to some of the Texans that they might as well bury the body of Montgomery a little better, they did not at all agree with me, but said it ought not to have been buried at all, but left hanging as a warning to other evildoers. With regard to the contentment of their slaves, Colonel Duff pointed out a good number they had with them, who had only to cross the river for freedom if they wished it. Colonel Bushell and I slept in Colonel Duff's tent, and at night we were serenaded. The officers and men really sang uncommonly well, and they finished with God Save the Queen. Colonel Duff comes from Perth. He was one of the leading characters in the secession of Texas, and he said his brother was a banker in Dunkeld. 10th April, Friday. We roused up at daylight, and soon afterwards Colonel Duff paraded some of his best men to show off the Texan horsemanship, of which they are very proud. I saw them lasso cattle and catch them by the tail at full gallop and throw them by slewing them round. This is called tailing. They pick small objects off the ground when at full tilt and, in their peculiar fashion, are beautiful riders. But they confessed to me they could not ride in an English saddle, and Colonel Duff told me that they could not jump a fence at all. They were all extremely anxious to hear what I thought of the performance, and their thorough good opinion of themselves was most amusing. At 9 o'clock, Colonel Bushell and I rode back to Brownsville, but as we lost our way twice and were enveloped in clouds of dust, it was not a very satisfactory ride. Poor Captain Hancock must be luxuriating at Baghdad, for with this wind the bar must be impassable to the boldest mariner. In the evening, a Texan Unionist, or renegado, gave us his sentiments at the consulate and drank a deal of brandy. He finished, however, by the toast, "Them as wants to fight, let 'em fight. I don't." 11th April, Saturday. The Unionist came to me this morning and said in a contrite manner, "I hope, Colonel, that in the fumes of brandy I didn't say anything offensive last night." I assured him that he hadn't. I have now become comparatively accustomed and reconciled to the necessity of shaking hands and drinking brandy with everyone. Author's note: this necessity does not exist except in Texas. The ambulance returned from Baghdad today. Captain Hancock had managed to cross the bar in Mr. Oetling's steamer or lighter, but was very nearly capsized. I went to a grand supper given by Mr. Oetling in honor of Mr. Hill's departure for the City of Mexico. This, it appears, is the custom of the country. 12th April, Sunday. I took an affectionate leave of Don Pablo, Benson, Oetling and company, all of whom were in rather weak health on account of last night's supper. The excellent Maloney insisted on providing me with preserved meats and brandy for my arduous journey through Texas. I feel extremely grateful for the kindness of all these gentlemen who rendered my stay in Matamoros very agreeable. The hotel would have been intolerable. I crossed to Brownsville at 3 p.m., where I was hospitably received by my friend Ituria, who confesses to having made a deal of money lately by cotton speculations. I attended evening parade and saw General B., Colonels Luckett, Bushell, Duff, and another gentleman. The latter, who hanged Montgomery, improves on acquaintance. General B. took me for a drive in his ambulance and introduced me to Major Leon Smith, who captured the Harriet Lane. The latter pressed me most vehemently to wait until General Magruder's arrival, and he promised, if I did so, that I should be sent to San Antonio in a first-rate ambulance. Major Leon Smith is a seafaring man by profession, and was put by General Magruder in command of one of the small steamers which captured the Harriet Lane at Galveston, the crews of the steamers being composed of Texan cavalry soldiers. He told me that the resistance offered after boarding was feeble, and he declared that, had not the remainder of the Yankee vessels escaped unfairly under flag of truce, they would likewise have been taken. After the Harriet Lane had been captured, she was fired into by the other ships, and Major Smith told me that, his blood being up, he sent the ex-master of the Harriet Lane to Commodore Renshaw, with a message that, unless the firing was stopped, he would massacre the captured crew. After hearing this, Commodore Renshaw blew up his ship, with himself in her, after having given an order to the remainder, sauve qui peut. 13th April, Monday. I breakfasted with General B. and took leave of all my Brownsville friends. McCarthy is to give me 4 times the value of my gold in Confederate notes. Author's note: the value of Confederate paper has since decreased. At Charleston I was offered 6-1 for my gold, and at Richmond 8-1. We left Brownsville for San Antonio at 11 a.m. Our vehicle was a roomy but rather overloaded 4-wheel carriage with a canvas roof and 4 mules. Besides McCarthy, there was a third passenger in the shape of a young merchant of the Hebrew persuasion. 2 horses were to join us to help us through the deep sand. The country, on leaving Brownsville, is quite flat, the road, a natural one, sandy and very dusty, and there are many small trees, principally mesquites. After we had proceeded 7 miles, we halted to water the mules. At 2 p.m. a new character appeared upon the scene, in the shape of an elderly, rough-faced, dirty-looking man who rode up, mounted on a sorry nag. To my surprise, he was addressed by McCarthy with the title of judge, and asked what he had done with our other horse. The judge replied that it had already broken down and had been left behind. McCarthy informs me that this worthy really is a magistrate or sort of judge in his own district, but he now appears in the capacity of assistant mule driver, and is to make himself generally useful. I could not help feeling immensely amused at this specimen of a Texan judge. We started again about 3 p.m., and soon emerged from the mesquite bushes into an open prairie 8 miles long, quite desolate and producing nothing but a sort of rush. After which we entered a chaparral, or thick covert of mesquite trees and high prickly pears. These border the track, and are covered with bits of cotton torn from the endless trains of cotton wagons. We met several of these wagons. Generally, there were 10 oxen or 6 mules to a wagon carrying 10 bales, but in deep sand more animals are necessary. They journey very slowly towards Brownsville, from places in the interior of Texas at least 500 miles distant. Want of water and other causes make the drivers and animals undergo much hardship. The judge rides on in front of us on his Rosinante to encourage the mules. His back view reminds one in a ludicrous manner of the pictures of Dr. Syntax. Mr. Sergeant, our portly driver, cheers his animals by the continual repetition of the sentence, "Get up now, you great long-eared goddamned son of a bitch." At 5 p.m. we reached a well with a farm or ranch close to it. Here we halted for the night. A cotton train was encamped close to us, and a lugubrious half-naked teamster informed us that three of his oxen had been stolen last night. In order to make a fire, we were forced to enter the chaparral for wood, and in doing so we ran many prickles into our legs, which caused us great annoyance afterwards, as they fester, if not immediately pulled out. The water at this well was very salt and made very indifferent coffee. McCarthy called it the meanest halting place we shall have. At 8 p.m. McCarthy spread a bullock rug on the sand near the carriage, on which we should have slept very comfortably had it not been for the prickles, the activity of many fleas, and the incursions of wild hogs. Mr. Sergeant and the judge, with much presence of mind, had encamped 70 yards off, and left to us the duty of driving away these hogs. I was twice awoke by one of these unclean animals breathing in my face. We did about 21 miles today. 14th April, Tuesday. When we roused up at 4 a.m., we found our clothes saturated with the heavy dew. Also that, notwithstanding our exertions, the hogs had devoured the greatest part of our pet kid, our only fresh meat. After feeding our mules upon the Indian corn we had brought with us, and drinking a little more salt water coffee, the judge hitched in, and we got underway at 5:30 a.m. The country just the same as yesterday, a dead level of sand, mesquite trees, and prickly pears. At 7:30 a.m. we reached Leatham's ranch and watered our mules. As the water was tolerable, we refilled our water barrels. I also washed my face, during which operation Mr. Sergeant expressed great astonishment, not unmingled with contempt. At Leatham's we met a wealthy Texan speculator and contractor called Major or Judge Hart. I find that our judge is also an MP, and that, in his capacity as a member of the Texan legislature, he is entitled to be styled the Honorable. At 9 a.m. we halted in the middle of a prairie, on which there was a little grass for the mules, and we prepared to eat. In the midst of our cooking, two deer came up quite close to us, and could easily have been killed with rifles. We saw quantities of rat ranches, which are big sort of molehills composed of cow dung, sticks, and earth, built by the rats. Mr. Sergeant, our conductor, is a very rough customer, a fat, middle-aged man who never opens his mouth without an oath, strictly American in its character. He and the judge are always snarling at one another, and both are much addicted to liquor. We live principally on bacon and coffee, but as the water and the bacon are both very salt, this is very inconvenient. We have, however, got some claret and plenty of brandy. During the midday halts, Mr. Sergeant is in the habit of cooling himself by removing his trousers, or pants, and having gorged himself, he lies down and issues his edicts to the judge as to the treatment of the mules. At 2:30 the MP hitched in again, and at 2:45 we reached a saltwater arm of the sea called the Arroyo del Colorado, about 80 yards broad, which we crossed in a ferry boat. Half an hour later we struck water again, which, being superior to Leatham's, we filled up. We are continually passing cotton trains going to Brownsville, also government wagons with stores for the interior. Near every well is a small farm or ranch, a miserable little wooden edifice surrounded by a little cultivation. The natives all speak Spanish and wear the Mexican dress. McCarthy is very proud of his knowledge of the country, in spite of which he is often out in his calculations. The different tracks are so similar to one another, they are easily mistaken. At 4:45 p.m. we halted at a much better place than yesterday. We are obliged to halt where a little grass can be found for our mules. Soon after we had unpacked for the night, six Texan Rangers of Wood's regiment rode up to us. They were very picturesque fellows, tall, thin, and ragged, but quite gentlemanlike in their manners. We are always to sleep in the open until we arrive at San Antonio, and I find my Turkish lantern most useful at night. Author's note, a lantern for a candle, made of white linen and wire, which collapses when not in use. They are always used in the streets of Constantinople. The Texans admired it immensely. 15th April, Wednesday. I slept well last night, in spite of the ticks and fleas, and we started at 5:30 a.m. After passing a dead rattlesnake 8 feet long, we reached water at 7 a.m. At 9 a.m. we espied the cavalcade of General Magruder passing us by a parallel track about half a mile distant. McCarthy and I jumped out of the carriage, and I ran across the prairie to cut him off, which I just succeeded in doing by borrowing the spare horse of the last man in the train. I galloped up to the front and found the general riding with an undeniably pretty woman, wife to an officer on Magruder's staff. She is naturally the object of intense attention to all the good-looking officers who accompany the general through this desert. General Magruder, who commands in Texas, is a fine soldier-like man of about 55, with broad shoulders, a florid complexion, and bright eyes. He wears his whiskers and moustaches in the English fashion, and he was dressed in the Confederate gray uniform. He was kind enough to beg that I would turn back and accompany him in his tour through Texas. He had heard of my arrival and was fully determined I should do this. He asked after several officers of my regiment whom he had known when he was on the Canadian frontier. He is a Virginian, a great talker, and has always been a great ally of English officers. He insisted that McCarthy and I should turn and dine with him, promising to provide us with horses to catch up Mr. Sergeant. After we had agreed to do this, I had a long and agreeable conversation with the general, who spoke of the Puritans with intense disgust, and of the first importation of them as that pestiferous crew of the Mayflower. But he is by no means rancorous against individual Yankees. He spoke very favorably of McClellan, whom he knew to be a gentleman, clever and personally brave, though he might lack moral courage to face responsibility. Magruder had commanded the Confederate troops at Yorktown, which opposed McClellan's advance. He told me the different dodges he had resorted to blind...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.